Hello friends, welcome to this web series of economics lecture. This economics lecture is based on IGNOU syllabus. What I'm trying to do it here to bring it on the student perspective of self-learning. So this web series is completely based on how I have learned and understood the concept of economics. This is the first class and the first one is based on theory of consumer behavior. Before going through this lecture, what we should know a little bit of theory of demand and theory of supply, which we all have learned either as part of our 11th or 12th syllabus, or if you have done MBA, then you might have learned in your economics classes. And you should also know a little bit about consumer utility, but I'll give you a little brief before going to this class is what is theory of demand and theory of demand. As you know, consumer demand is linked in very intricately with your prices. So if prices of goods falls down, consumer demands picks up. So you might have heard in the news that RBI economics policy, every quarter it releases those policy and it set the rate, and this rate is based on the inflation. So what is inflation? Inflation is the change in the prices, measurement of the change in the prices. So if you are a goods A, and consider in your country there is only one good, that is A. So prices of A is like P1 in quarter 1 and P2 in quarter 2. So inflation is something your P2 minus P1. So that and percentage of P2 minus P1 divided by P1. So that's a percentage inflation. If prices falls down, it's deflation. If prices goes up, it's inflation. So now, why I'm telling you this, just to give you a very practical example of theory of demand. When inflation goes up, that means your prices are going very up. And what does RBI do in that case? RBI set the rate. RBI actually increases the rate at which the bank lend to you. And what does mean if rate increases the bank at which bank lend to you? That means money is getting costly. That means in order to this price which is increasing, in order to counter that, what RBI is trying to do? It is trying to make money more expensive. If money becomes more expensive, that means demand will reduce. So yesterday, if you are getting a car on 1 lakh and today that car and you are going you have taken loan to buy that car, and if rate of interest of that loan is increasing, that means you have to pay more to buy that car. So you might defer your decision to buy that car. You are thinking, no, I'll not buy it this time because rate is more. So probably I'll buy after 1 and 2 quarters. In that case, what will happen? The demand will decrease. Once the demand will decrease, what will happen? This prices which is increasing, that will be arrested. So that is the whole cycle. The whole cycle how the consumer demand works. So this is basically combination of both your microeconomics and macroeconomics. So I'm not going to going very deep in here, but this is just to give a taste that how demand works. So basically demand is inversely proportional to your price. So this is not very simple formula between demand and price. It could be very complicated and intricate, but basically it is inverse. It could be any function, but it has to be inverse. For normal goods, again, I'm underlying these things. For normal goods, if good could be different, I mean, if it's an inferior goods, that means if price decreases, I'll tell you about normal, inferior, and superior goods. For normal goods, so this is the demand curve will be like, this is your price and this is your quantity. So price decreases, then your quantity increases. Similarly, price increases, then your quantity decreases. So basically, it's an inverse relationship. It could be either this curve or that curve, but it's an inverse curve between price and quantity. Similarly, if you talk about the theory of supply, so you know, when you talk about supply, then consumer goes out of there, then producer comes, because producer supply the goods to the market. So what will happen? Then it's a positive relation between your price and quantity, because producer, if they get the less price, they would want to sell less goods. So if your price is decreasing, consider then what happens, some producers stop producing because they don't want to produce when they could either go into loss or they could earn less profit in that case, or if it's a more price, they will supply more. So it's an inverse relation. This is your supply curve, this is your demand curve. So that means if your price is increasing, your quantity is increasing. So what happens in your perfect competitive market? Your price curve and demand curve intersect each other and you get a point which is called an equilibrium point. That is the point where equilibrium is achieved, where producer is also happy and consumer is also happy. The goods is affordable to their pocket, and price is such that producer is making enough profit for their production. So and that is called the equilibrium point, and that is the goods they are getting produced and supplied in demand and at this price. So this is a basic, I'm not going very deep here, this is a very basic of theory of supply and demand. Now a little bit of utility. I'm just giving you a basic concept before moving ahead deep into consumer behavior. Little bit of utility. So what is utility? So utility, as a meaning, you understand that utility is a concept the way you utilize something, the goods. So in economics, what is the utility? Because the definition of economics, you understand that what economics tries that to maximize your utilization or to maximize or something to derive the maximum value and to a given constraint. So for any product or anything, the basic aim of economics is to derive the maximum value out of it given the constraint it is working on. So that is what utility is. So utility in economics is measured in terms of how consumer consume the goods. So when you talk about the consumers in economics, so it mainly focuses on what consumers buys and how much it buys. So it basically focuses on how much, that is your quantity. So utility is basically in directly proportional to your quantity. So and basically quantity is the utility. The much you consume, the gives you the value of utility, the quantity. It could be a different function. You consider it's a two goods world where your only goods is X or Y. In that case, your utility might be quantity of X1 into quantity of Y1, which is a very basic formula for utility. It could be pretty complex also based on how much satisfaction X goods is giving and Y goods giving. So that is what your utility is about. Utility is basically function of your quantity. But we will learn that more in theory of consumer behavior, that how do we maximize consumer utility and on what basis. So that is our basically our whole idea of whole consumer behavior is based on that. So moving forward, just to give you a basic definition of theory of consumer behavior, derive it. So consumer theory is the study of how people decide to spend their money and decide to spend their money based on their preferences and their constraints. So what is their constraint? Their constraint is their income. So how much they are spending their money on the goods, and they have the constraint because they cannot spend more than their income. Given we are not bringing on the concept of credit or loan or those things over here, we will just talk about the constraint is their income. So even if we talk about the credit, we could add credit to our income, and then that would be their maximum constraint. So consumer behavior is a branch of microeconomics which shows that how consumer make their choices subject to their income available to them and the prices of goods and services in the market. So that is the whole idea about the consumer behavior. The next, moving forward, we are going to learn how do we measure utility. So how do we measure the utility? So there are different approaches in economics. One is cardinal and another is ordinal. Under cardinal and ordinal also you have different approaches to derive it, but we'll go one by one. So looking into the cardinal approach, by name itself you can understand it's cardinal. So you can derive utility numerically in terms of money. So this is the approach where you quantify the utility based on certain formula. So if we talk about assumption of cardinal, since economics is a study based on different assumption, you cannot derive economical formula or something in that unless you assume. So you have to make assumption in cardinal approach because you are trying to quantify your utility. So assumption, different assumption is your consumer should be rational, which is understandable. If consumer is irrational, you cannot predict their behavior, then you cannot theorize anything. So consumer has to be rational. Another is utility always depends on the quantity, which we have already seen that utility depends on quantity. And third is third, you can say the goods are good. More consumer consume, more good it is. So we are talking about greed here, which is acceptable in economy. So that is, so goods are good. That is the third assumption. So using the cardinal approach, if we say that if we are talking about maximize the utility, our approach is to find out what is the maximum quantity consumer can consume given its constraint, without thinking whether more good could be bad, because assumption is goods are good. The fourth is marginal utility is diminishing. So what is marginal utility? So marginal utility is, so it is a change in your utility with change in your quantity that you consume, unit change, basically unit change. So consider when you are consuming quantity 10 and you have derived utility as 40 for that, and then when you consume 10, what it 11, I mean the unit change of plus 1, what would be the utility? Consider it's 42. That means your marginal utility is 2. So 2 is the difference in the utility with the change in unit quantity. Okay, so what happens in the marginal utility? So your utility might be increasing, but your unit change will keep on decreasing. So your marginal utility will be diminishing. So consider you consuming good 10, your marginal utility is 40. You consuming good 11, it is 41. Then consider it's 45 kind of, and then 12, then it will become 13, then 49, consider is 53 14, consider is 55. Consider is 52 and this is 55. So now if you see, according to the assumption, your marginal utility keep on decreasing with increasing quantity. So the marginal utility here is 5, here it's 4, here it's 3, yes, and again consider it as 54, and here it is 2. So according to the assumption, this is your marginal utility. So it is change in utility with your unit change in quantity, that is called your marginal utility. So your change in utility du, which is change in utility with change in unit quantity, that is your marginal utility. So m1 minus m2 minus m1 divided by q2 minus q1, right? So that is it, and this will be, so your utility might be increasing. So we know that we consume more goods, we get more utility. So that is true here. You consume more goods, you get more utility, but your marginal utility will be diminishing. So when you are marginal utility, when you are consuming 10 was 4, but when you are consuming 14 was only 2. So despite your utility is increasing, marginal utility keeps decreasing with increasing quantity. That's your fourth assumption. So we have seen four assumptions as part of cardinal approach. The first assumption was consumers would be rational. Second assumption was your utility is measured in terms of quantity. Third assumption was goods are good. You consume good, it is good. The fourth assumption is marginal utility is diminishing. So even your utility increases with increasing goods, your marginal utility diminishes with increase of good consumed. And third is utility of money is always constant. And another way utility is measured in terms of money. So so basically in a market, if you see, if your price is whatever you earn, you spend on the goods, so that will become your PQ divided by PQ is equal to your income or your money. If you are spending everything, you are not saving anything. So in that case, since U is proportional to Q, right, and your Q is M by P. So basically U is also measured in terms of money. So that is your fifth assumption. Utility can be measured in terms of money. And the last assumption is marginal utility of money is constant. So why it is that? Because the value of money doesn't change. We are not talking about exchange rate or your forex loss or gain here. So if your money, so whatever the value of money is, when you are buying one goods, if the value at the 10 rupees, and so two goods, value of money never, it is always constant. So basically you can say that DM is zero. So marginal utility of DM by DQ is zero. So utility of money with respect to quantity will always remain constant. It will not change. So it doesn't matter if you are consuming 10 goods now, what is the value of money is now, it's going to remain same if you consume 20 goods. Money, value of money will not reduce like your utility. So that is your all six assumption of your cardinal approach. Now if we go to how do we derive it, cardinal, so in the cardinal approach, how do you derive the utility? So basically your net utility is equal to the utility you derive, you get from consuming your goods. Okay, so utility you get from consuming your good minus utility you have reduced because you have lost some money on spending this goods. So consider lambda is the utility of money. Then what is the money? This is the money you spend on good, right? So Q is a quantity, P is price, and lambda is utility of money, which is constant always. We saw as part of our sixth assumption that utility of marginal utility of money is constant. Sorry, that d lambda will be constant, not lambda. So this is your utility formula. in ordinal theory. So if you want to maximize your utility, you know from the mathematical formula that you have to find the derivative and then using by differentiating it by the first order derivative, if you make it zero, you can find out the maximum x here or q here, quantity. Okay, we will derive it like consider. So if we take d nu by dq, so we'll have to differentiate this also. But before that, if we want to maximize it at your consumer equilibrium, what will happen? What your max change in utility nu by net utility will become zero. Net utility, which is your utility minus your utility what you have lost because of spending the money, that means whatever you are consuming, it becomes equal to whatever you are spending. So that will become zero at equilibrium. So now if this becomes zero, what happens? Duq by dq will become lambda p. Q differentiate to 1, then dq by dq will become 1. So duq by dq becomes lambda p. Okay. So consider you want to just keep this formula in mind and take an example, like if your ux is log x, so your utility is of x good is logarithmic of x, and p is equal to 2, lambda is equal to 2, px consider is 2, which is your price into curve. So how do you define your x here? So take this. So if you dq by dx, it will become 1 by x, will equal to lambda p, lambda into p. Okay. Px price of good. So 1 by x will become 2 into 2. So x will become 1 by 4. So this is how you derive it. At the equilibrium, consumer equilibrium, this. So this is your basically your cardinal approach, and So next we'll go to ordinal.